Okay, so we're very happy to have Veronica Hubli here today. She is a professor at the physics department and the center for quantum mathematics and physics at UC Davis. She's been there since 2014. Before she was a student actually in Santa Barbara, then she was a postdoc here in Stanford. And then she started the faculty job in Durham, spending also some time in Berkeley. And then after a bit of a break, she came back to California. She's very well known in the field of quantum gravity and general relativity, and in particular for her contribution to the subfield of entanglement and holography, of which she will talk about today. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thanks very much. Well, it's wonderful to be back here. My postdoc years are some of the happiest years of my life. It was wonderful, so it's always very nostalgic to come back. So the talk is basically spans a large set of things that I have been working on throughout my academic career. Black holes in particular are my favorite objects in physics, but when I was a grad student, it was just around the time that the gauge gravity duality, or the ABCFD, came out, so I spent most of my time immersed and fascinated by the subject. And in the recent decade or so, I have turned more towards sort of a more quantum information theoretic part of that broad set of things. And so I'll tell you about all of these things. They a priori, it sounds like they're very disparate subjects, but there's a thread, there's a connection between them that I'll try to give you a glimpse of. So I have, Stanford is a birthplace of many, if not almost all of these ideas, and so there are many experts that you have right here, and very little of what I'll say is gets to the level of my own contributions, but I'd like to give you at least sort of a complementary perspective on these things. So let me start sort of philosophically a little bit of stepping back and explaining why I like black holes so much, one of the reasons I like black holes so much. And that harks back to, one of the overarching goals of physics is finding a unified description, and often that usefully proceeds by considering various extreme regimes, and some of the most obvious ones are thinking about the world of the sort of very massive, or very fast, or very small, and in the space of the fundamental constants of nature, you can think of it as ramping up the Newton's constant, or inverse speed of light, or Planck's constant, so that the gravitational, or relativistic, or quantum effects are significant. And, well, so as you know, the relativistic theory of gravity, general relativity, underlies our standard model of cosmology, and this beautiful, elegant description that's very well tested and very well understood. The relativistic quantum field theory underlies the standard model of particle physics, but, and again, exquisite theory, but they're mutually, as they stand, the theories are mutually incompatible, and so one of the sort of holy grails was to find a unified description that both contains gravity and is a quantum, genuinely quantum theory, dubbed quantum gravity. Of course, string theory is one of the, well, is the leading candidate for this, but we still don't understand the full framework well enough to answer many of the deep, outstanding questions. But the more modern viewpoint on all this is that, well, you really need more than just thinking about unifying these directions. And in particular, there's other ways of going to extreme regimes. So as many of you are very familiar with, the physics of many, sort of very many constituents has a novel sort of emergent phenomena captured by in statistical mechanics, and the complexity, like quantum complexity, is yet another direction that we're sort of just starting to understand. So quantum information theory, which has been traditionally confined more to sort of computer science departments or national labs, now is making its way into physics departments and is having a very strong bearing on almost everything we do nowadays. So the viewpoint is now you need all of these ingredients to understand quantum gravity. And black holes turn out to be playing continually from the very beginning, are playing a key role in this quest. And so I will start by talking about black holes, first from a sort of more astrophysical standpoint. So, well, when you mention the word black holes, many people have different impressions. Some people tend to think in terms of equations and diagrams, some people think in terms of astrophysical objects, some people even think in terms of science fiction. So I must say that even the wildest imaginings of science fiction can't compete with how elegantly designed nature actually is in real life. But so from the GR, general relativity standpoint, what are black holes? Well, they're defined simply as a region in space-time from which nothing can escape and from which you can't communicate with the external universe. So in nature, this typically occurs when a sufficiently massive star ends its thermonuclear burning phase and collapses under gravity. And according to general relativity, which posits that matter, but gravity is nothing but a manifestation of space-time curvature, and matter in turn curves space-time, the space-time curved by this collapsing star is such that it changes the causal structure so that there's a region from which you can't get back out. So this is illustrated by these light cones. Any physical signal must be moving always within the light cone, and at some point the light cones tip over. In Newtonian parlance, it will be just the gravitational potential well here. It gets so deep that light can't escape. In GR parlance, it's just these light cones tipping such that there is this point of no return called the event horizon from within which you can never get back out. But otherwise, there is nothing, according to classical general relativity, there is nothing special happening at the event horizon. It's this teleological construct, and once you get in, you can't get out. So it's a very mild thing locally, but it has a very rich and very interesting physics. For something that's defined so teleologically, it depends on the entire future of what happens later on. So we might say, okay, it shouldn't have any interesting physics associated with it, because it's completely teleological, you can't measure where it actually is, and yet it behaves like many everyday sort of objects. Now, another feature that typically occurs, well, in this picture it certainly occurs, is that when you have such a collapsing object, it typically, well, forms a, necessarily if you have a collapsing object, it forms a singularity, and a singularity where the curvature of the space-time becomes arbitrarily large. And so the evolution in general relativity just breaks down, which is an obvious signature that GR needs to be replaced by something more, something that's valid all the way through in the evolution, which would be quantum gravity if we had enough control over it to figure out what happens here. So far, we don't have a full description to understand how to resolve most curvature singularities, such as the one formed by collapsing stars. So in a sense, general relativity predicts its own downfall, because this is not any fine-tuned type of thing, say from just spherically symmetric situations. It's a very robust feature. All right. So now, in everyday life, we don't really encounter curved space-time consciously. I mean, Space-time is approximately flat where we are, so unless we have very high precision instruments, we don't really get to observe the curvature. Now, that said, we all do have, or most of us, high precision instruments. So for example, the global positioning system, the GPS units in your cell phones, are sensitive enough that in fact the general relativistic corrections are crucial. Without them, your location would get awry within a matter of minutes. So we do encounter indirectly GR in our everyday lives, but in our cosmos, the effects are much more striking. So most of you have probably seen this movie many times, but I like it so much that I can't resist showing it once more. So what you see here is a starry sky, just like our own, but in the foreground, there's two black holes. So it looks like holes in the background, but that's not the case. They're foreground objects, and they bend, but they're manifestations of this curved spacetime. And so in particular, light, which travels through this curved spacetime, travels along the straightest possible paths, but in the curved spacetime, that means that those paths are bent. And so it acts like a lens in the foreground through which you're seeing the background. And so this is better seen when I run the movie. So the black holes orbit around each other, and so the light from the distant stars behind them shifts around as these effective lenses are moving around. And you can see that as they move, they ripple out the space-time. So these are gravitational waves that you see going out, and they carry out energy, and so the black holes eventually coalesce like this. And when that happens, this is such an energetic process that if that energy was converted to light, for that moment it would have altered the entire rest of the universe. These are highly powerful objects. Now, of course, if you want to observe black holes directly, that's very hard because by definition nothing escapes from a black hole, so of course you can't see anything from inside. The black hole doesn't emit any light. But as you have seen, it's a dramatic effect on the entire space-time around it. So we see the effects of the space-time curvature if you have any objects in the vicinity of the black hole. So for example, our black hole at the center of our galaxy, Sagittarius A star, was detected by looking at orbits of stars in its vicinity. If a star gets very close to a comparably sized black hole, then in fact, because different parts of the star now want to travel at very different trajectories in the space-time, okay, because they have different notion of the straightest path, that those tidal forces are strong enough to literally rip stars apart. And of course, because there's such a deep, you know, gravitational potential well, again in Newtonian language, as the matter falls onto the black hole, it forms this accretion disk which heats up through frictional effects, and you can see this telltale signs in the spectra of such objects. So you can detect black holes very easily through this way, the telltale signs, but now in addition we have new eyes on the universe. So first of all, we already have entered very successfully into the era of the gravitational wave detections. And we're also on the brink of, well, what you might even call a black hole photography through this Event Horizon Telescope. So for the gravitational wave detection, I mean, this was an enormous human achievement decades long in making, but finally almost precisely 100 years after Einstein formulated general relativity, the first gravitational waves were actually detected, and this takes a sensitivity of like 1 part of 10 to the 21. But since then, so you detect the signal that from which you can read off the various attributes, such as the masses and spins of the black holes. And since then, 10 more events have been detected. So this seems like a very fruitful new era, mostly for astrophysical type observations,
estimating how many such black holes there are and so forth. So this diagram shows for the events how big the black holes, the initial two black holes were, and what's the size of the final black hole they emerged into. Okay, so that's data from LIGO. This Event Horizon Telescope is completely different. It's a set of radio telescopes using this very long baseline interferometry stations all around the Earth. And so you get a very sensitive, very narrow angular resolution. And then if you have a black hole which has an accretion disk around it, some source of light, and your angular resolution is sharp enough to detect that, which is totally remarkable that they can manage, but they did manage, then you can actually resolve it. So so the angular resolution to observe the supermassive black hole at the center of our galaxy is about 50 microarc seconds, which, by the way, is like seeing the angular resolution of a tennis ball on placed on the moon. There's another supermassive black hole, much bigger, in a galaxy much further away, which is about 20 microarc seconds. But this instrument actually can detect that. And tomorrow at 8 in the morning, there should be the announcement of the first data from this. Okay, so this is more of an artist's conception, and it will probably be like one or two pixels that you will be able to see. But nevertheless, this is a completely new type of imaging. Okay, so this is all was just to motivate that black holes really are real physical objects out there in the universe, and we now have estimates, at least lower bounds, on how many there are, and there are lots. So even in our own galaxy, there's 100 million black holes, and so if you sum up all the galaxies by some good estimates, you would imagine something like 10 to the 17 black holes. Those are roughly a set of solar mass type black holes, or up to 100 solar masses or something. Each galaxy, roughly speaking, has a supermassive black hole at its center, so 10 to the 6 to 10 to the 9 solar masses. So Sagittarius A star is a small one compared to the spectrum. It's about 4 million solar masses. There's a statistically a black hole created from collapse every second. So by the time I finish the talk, there will be thousands more. None of them are observed particularly near. So the nearest one, to my knowledge, that had been observed is some 1600 light years away still. But there it is. Okay, so I have reviewed all this primarily. This is not sort of my main focus, but I wanted to illustrate a point that, black holes are physical, they're out there in the universe, and they're very extreme objects. So already the sort of densest known regular object in astrophysics is a neutron star, and that one is so dense that a handful of it, 2 tablespoons of it, would weigh as much as a kilometer cube slab of lead. Black holes are much more compact than that. So, for example, if the entire Earth collapsed to form a black hole, it would be this big. So they're very extreme objects. And so you might say that, here on Earth, the gravitational effects are pretty small, the space-time is almost flat, and we need a highly precise instrument to detect the space-time curvature. And so, gravity should have very little bearing on our tabletop experiments or our high-energy experiments, all those things. Okay, which to some extent is true, yet nevertheless, black holes actually turn out to have a bearing or to describe systems that we do encounter in real life, in nature, at least systems that are in the same universality class. So it's very remarkable that black holes have many guises, and the ones that I have, the astrophysical one that I have told you about so far, is in some sense the least, to me, is the least fascinating. Black holes are much more than these really cool astrophysical objects. So they're
mathematically elegant. Okay, you might wonder, okay, such extreme objects, how can they be anywhere near simple? In fact, I think it has, the two facts are actually deeply connected. But be it as it may, they are mathematically very nice, and that allows us to study them explicitly. And through such studies, we have discovered that black holes actually lie at the heart of dualities, which I'll describe in the second part of the talk. And through that, we have learned that black holes really are related to ordinary systems. And there is the thing that I mentioned at the beginning, which they probe the key to understanding or unearthing quantum gravity. So I'll try to describe this in the rest of the talk. All right, so let me start with a sort of just give you a very little bit of a point about the mathematical description, just to illustrate the expectations. Why is it that black holes are so powerful as a theoretical laboratory? So they are, so black holes are constructs within general relativity that formulated by Einstein 100 years ago. And the solutions to Einstein's equations, which tell us how the curvature of space-time is related to matter distribution, the solutions are very simple. In fact, Chandrasekhar called them the most perfect macroscopic objects that are in the universe, because the only ingredients that go into the construction are our notions of space and time. And, well, we can illustrate that by thinking about, for example, if you collapse a star, the star itself is pretty complicated. You can throw all sorts of interesting information into it and so forth. And if it collapses into a black hole, all these things get lost in the black hole. The black hole initially, of course, is rippled up from the stuff that fell in, but it settles down very quickly. In fact, black holes erode the fastest of any physical object in the universe. They scramble information the fastest and so forth. So very quickly it settles down into a state which classically is characterized just by three numbers, not even functions, just numbers, that the whole space-time is described precisely once you know the total mass, the total angular momentum, and the total charge, which in astrophysics is typically zero. But John Wheeler coined the phrase black holes have no hair to describe this fact. And that fact allows us to study, well, a little bit more than that fact, but that underlies the simplicity, which then allows us to study the properties of black holes explicitly. And looking back, retrospectively, we found many surprises. Okay, so the earliest one, and a very far-reaching one, was that black holes behave like ordinary objects in a thermodynamical sense. So the stationary black holes are characterized, as I said, by these only three parameters. And important characteristics that crop up are the surface area of the event horizon, and another quantity which is called surface gravity. It corresponds to the amount of force that you would have to exert out at infinity to hold a unit mass object suspended just above the horizon. Okay, sounds pretty abstruse, but this quantity is actually has a very interesting role to play, which comes from looking at how black holes behave if you, say, throw objects into them and they go in response in a particular way. So the laws of black hole mechanics, which capture this behavior, mimic the laws of ordinary thermodynamics. So the surface gravity is constant over the entire horizon. The mass grows in a certain way that's related to the growth in the horizon area with a coefficient given by the surface gravity. The area has to always increase in a physical classical process, and it's impossible to take surface gravity to zero by, again, any physical process. And so you see that there's a clear correspondence between the surface gravity and the temperature and the area and the entropy,
and of course the mass is the energy, and so it's natural to identify these parameters.
Now, in classical general relativity, nothing comes out of the black hole, so black holes can't radiate, so the notion of temperature is sort of suspect, but it turns out that semi-classically, is the case that black holes have temperature, and in fact, the fact that black holes, already before that, the black holes having entropy was motivated by certain Gennaget experiments of throwing matter into black holes and seeing that using the second law of thermodynamics that the entropy that was in the matter can somehow be lost from the universe. But the actual substantiation was the famous calculation by Stephen Hawking of actually semi-classically realizing that black holes actually do radiate at a given temperature that is indeed proportional to the surface gravity. And so from this you can read off the coefficient that has to accompany the area relation between area and black hole entropy. And I have, normally I would just write the entropy is quarter of the area, setting all the fundamental constants to one, but I have reinstated them to illustrate a point that if you want to understand why this is the case, well, because it involves all of these, well, it has features from all of these subjects in physics. So it really consolidates lots of the structure, which is harking back to my initial slide. And in fact, it is still an outstanding question, and a great testing ground for any iterative theory of quantum gravity, is to find a sort of microscopic description of why is there this entropy, which by the way is humongous. So, I mean, it's for solar mass black hole, you would get the entropy itself something like 10 to the 77. And so if you think of it as an origin in statistical mechanics of having a given number of microstates, that's exponential of that, so it's a humongous number. Despite the fact that classically you just have three parameters to characterize this black hole. Okay, so this is still an outstanding question which has been computed exactly in string theory for specific black holes, but not for all black holes. Okay, so let me get back to the stuff that what does this relation tell us, taking it for at face value? And then let me go back. There we go. Okay. So the fact that black holes radiate at some temperature means that they're losing their mass, the event horizon is shrinking, and so the area law, the second law of thermodynamics equivalent, that area should be increasing, does not apply. It does not apply because the assumptions that were in this theorem are not satisfied, namely the energy conditions are not satisfied, because quantum mechanically you can have locally negative energies. And so what's nevertheless true is, of course, that the second law of thermodynamics holds, and so this generalized second law is saying that the combined entropy in coming from the black hole horizon area and from all the matter, or in particular the Hawking radiation of the black hole, that must keep increasing. Now, these considerations led to observing that, if you wanted to pack as much entropy in a given region, a spherical region which is slowly evolving, that amount of entropy has to also be bounded by the area, surface area of this region, rather than its volume. Which is surprising because we're used to entropy being extensive. As you might imagine, if you have twice the volume, you can pack in twice the amount of information. That story is when you don't have effects of gravity. Once you have effects of gravity, then once you pack in a sufficient amount of information, sufficient amount of stuff, it will collapse to a black hole, and black holes can't exceed this bound. But this
formulation is talking about a spatial area at a given point in time. But in general relativity, space and time are treated sort of on equal footing. And this formulation is not sufficient. So you need to sort of covariantize it, which was done by this covariant entropy bound for a full, it's a full space-time construct. And it's based on something called light sheets, where you take, so you take a spatial volume, the sigma is its surface area, and the statement is that the entropy passing through a certain construct called light sheet must be bounded by the area of the surface. So what is this light sheet? It's a set of, it's a congruence of null perpendicular light rays that are emitted from this light sheet such that they're converging together. Okay? Once they start expanding or they cross each other, you cut off the light sheet. And that relation now is true in general, again, subject to some energy assumptions. And it improves on the previous one, which holds for some situations, but not, for example, if you collapse a star into a black hole or in cosmology, and so forth. So this a lesson from this is that uplifting to a full space-time picture ended up being giving the correct or and a more useful construct. Again, this burst the notion that in a theory of gravity, since the amount of information you can pack in a given passing through a given area, passing through a given light sheet is bounded by the area of a surface, well then the number of degrees of freedom required to describe the physics must also scale with the area, and therefore there should be some autonomous description, some theory that captures that. Okay, so that's the rough idea that, well, there should be a physical equivalence between two theories that are living in different number of dimensions. So that's a holographic principle. It's very vague, but it has a wonderful realization in this gauge gravity duality that I mentioned earlier that was constructed independently by thinking about black holes originally in the context of string theory. Okay, so let me tell you about the gauge gravity duality, also known as ADS-CFT correspondence, already formulated more than two decades ago. And very roughly, it equates, it's a duality between certain string theory, which among others is a theory of gravity, and a gauge theory, a quantum field theory that doesn't manifest gravity. It happens to be a conformal field theory, so hence the name. The gravity, the string theory, lives in bulk of anti-D sitter spacetime, so hence the name ADS-CFT duality. The gauge theory lives on the boundary of the spacetime. So in early days, people like to think of this as an analogy of a soup can. So I can't resist showing the soup can analogy, which is it's a joke because the conformal diagram of this anti-D sitter spacetime, which is a maximally symmetric negatively curved spacetime, looks like a cylinder like this. Okay, so the analogy is that the gravity, the string theory, is like the soup inside the can, and the CFT is like the boundary. It's like the label on the soup can, but unlike the ordinary soup can where the label just gives you a rough idea of what's inside, here the label really does tell you everything. And because the two descriptions live in different number of dimensions, this correspondence was called holographic. Harking back to the holographic principle, it has nothing to do with actual holograms. And in fact, I think maybe a better analogy would have been something like a stereogram, which you have seen these pictures where if you stare at them long enough, you might see a 3D image coming out of them. Here it would be due to correlations between pairs of these splotches that the eyes interpret as parallax. In actual ADS-CFT, it would be infinitely more complicated because there's infinitely more, you know, correlations, and the splotches would have a very autonomous, sensible picture as a CFT on its own. But nevertheless, okay, so that's just another analogy. But it's already clear that, well, no matter what, the spatial information, and in fact even the temporal information, gets mixed up between the two sides. And so the first question you might ask when encountering such a holographic duality is, what happened to that extra bulb direction? In this case, this would be this radial direction that goes towards the boundary, that's not present on the boundary in the boundary theory. And we already get nice hints from just looking at the spatial geometry, which is nicely described by one of these Escher pictures. It's a Poincaré disk type geometry where this rim is the boundary, it's infinitely far away, but each of these fishes has constant proper distance. Constant proper distance, and so you have to traverse infinitely many of them to get all the way to the boundary. And no point here is a preferred origin. There's a large symmetry. And so it had better be that if I want to describe, say, some point here in the bulk by something on the boundary, the boundary description must have the same symmetry as in the bulk. The fact that none of these points is a preferred origin, for example. And so from that you can you can formulate that, well, the radial direction must have something to do with the scale size on the boundary. So that's what Lenin called in the early days the scale radius duality, also known as UVIR duality. If you take points near the boundary, they would be described by small arcs. If you take points further into the bulk, they would be described by larger arcs. And I like this picture from all these Escher pictures even more because it most nicely illustrates the point that, well, these arcs are not unique. You could have taken any other arc through this point. And so that has been more recently reinterpreted in terms of quantum error correction, which, by the way, all the Anhiri, Dong, and Harlow, all of whom have the roots in Stanford. So far, this was just about the spatial geometry. And I think one very important ingredient which has not really been incorporated sufficiently is that the temporal mixing up is also very important and I think will lead to very useful clues. But so far, much of the, well, and I'll get to the sort of the temporal version, the space-time version of this in later on in the talk. But already we can use this as an intuition building exercise to predict what would happen for simple processes, how they get mapped between the boundary and the bulk. So for example, if you put a bulk particle near the boundary, it will feel the gravitational potential well in the bulk and it would fall in. As it falls in, under just gravity, on the boundary, it would correspond to a localized excitation that spreads out, which is exactly what we would expect. In fact, if you have a black hole in the bulk, so you imagine that these fish would be deformed in a corresponding way, but anyway, the particle would again fall towards into the black hole, and as it approaches the horizon, this scale size of this boundary, corresponding boundary excitation, would spread, and it would precisely, the black hole's temperature would correspond to the sort of thermal temperature of the boundary state, and so the description would be that the boundary, which has no gravity, thermalizes. In fact, you can understand black holes as thermal states in the boundary simply because they're the natural end state of a generic process. So if you, in the bulk, if you collapse, if you put in a large amount of energy, it will collapse to form a large black hole at some temperature. On the boundary, there is no gravity, so nothing collapses, but things thermalize. And the thermal state at the same temperature corresponds, again, in this very rough picture, corresponds to the black hole. But we want to do much better. And in fact, people have sort of probed this dictionary or understood, developed this dictionary very well, well enough to have very fruitful physics developments from it. So there's in the gravitational theory, well, as I said, that it's generic systems are large black holes, and you can study the various response properties of these black holes. In the field theory side, it's a strongly coupled quantum many-body system, and so there are many systems in nature that are in the same characteristic class, same universality class, as the quantum field theory that we have in holography. And so many of such experimentally accessible systems behave akin to, well, have a dual description in terms of higher dimensional black hole. Okay, so you can study properties of many of these systems, and often such systems don't, well, especially those systems don't have a quasi-particle-like description, it can be the case that, in fact, studying the dual higher dimensional gravitational system is the best bet, even quantitatively, for understanding some of these. Okay, but the information flow should go both ways, and in fact, one should also be able to use the quantum field theory to learn about quantum gravity once one understands the dictionary well enough. So the types of things that we're still after understanding better are things like, well, how does the bulk dynamical space sound that you can back react and that's dynamically behave back reacting from matter that's in the space-time and all that. How does that emerge from the non-gravitational degrees of freedom within the field theory? Which quantities give rise to the bulk metric? What determines the actual dynamics, the equations of motion of this metric? So the Einstein's equation. How does one recover, say, a local bulk operator from the CFT data? There's a refinement, there's a tower of more and more refined questions. And in fact, further refinement is, suppose you know just some bit of the information on the boundary of the CFT, what does that correspond to in the bulk? Suppose you only know a state in the field theory without knowing the dynamics, is there a corresponding restriction in the bulk that you might know some region, but maybe not the whole? Look, or if you have a restriction of knowing only some subset, spatial subregion of the boundary, how much does that correspond to in the bulk? And more interestingly, if you have one of these black holes, so we see that you can't see into a black hole, nothing escapes from a black hole, so a bulk observer would not see the interior of a black hole. But the CFT is a complete autonomous description. It's a unitary theory that captures all of the physics. It should capture what happens when objects fall into the black hole in the bulk dual. It should capture what happens to them when they hit the curvature singularity. It should know all that. So one should be able to query the field theory to figure out the things that we couldn't have figured out from just classical GI as bulk observers. Okay, but how exactly does that happen? That's still an outstanding question. Okay, how does it resolve curvature singularities? But there's very intriguing hints that much of it comes from, well, okay, that there's connections, deep connections, to quantum entanglement. Okay, so let me now turn the page and talk about quantum entanglement. So entanglement as such is, not only a sort of essential feature of any quantum system, but in fact the most non-classical manifestation of quantum mechanics. And mathematically, it's related to the, it's present when the full state of a composite system cannot be described as a product of the states of the individual subsystems. And this fact that the best possible knowledge of a whole does not contain the best possible knowledge of its parts has perplexed physicists from the early days of quantum mechanics, but it still underlies the deep puzzles even today. But more recently, people have recast the notion of entanglement as a quantum resource for performing tasks that can be achieved using just classical resources, like quantum teleportation and so forth. And so entanglement has now started playing a central role in a wide range of fields, from obviously quantum information to studying quantum many-body systems, quantum field theories, and more recently, quantum gravity. There's these hints to connections to geometry. Okay, so entanglement is nicely captured by a quantity called entanglement entropy, and it characterizes the amount of mixedness. If you take if you partition your full system into, say, two parts, let's say you only know the subsystem A and not its complement, then you can form the reduced density matrix by tracing over the stuff that you don't know, and the von Neumann entropy of that reduced density matrix is something called entanglement entropy, which measures this mixedness. So that's defined when you can subdivide, partition your full system like this. And in a local quantum field theory, there's a very natural partitioning by restricting to a spatial region. And so you can think that, say, you know all the physics in this room, but you don't know anything outside, so you trace over everything outside. And that gives you some von Neumann entropy of the reduced density matrix for the inside. Okay, so that would correspond to this entanglement entropy. Okay, now there's a good news and bad news. Let's start with the bad news. The bad news is that it's a very intricate, sensitive object, and so it's very hard to deal with. It's non-local. It's hard to measure, if possible at all. It's hard to calculate in all but the simplest contexts, and especially so in a strongly coupled quantum systems. But we've been trained since the early days of ADS-EFT to always wonder, well, if you have a strongly interacting quantum system, well, ADS-EFT should be useful for hard questions. And so the obvious question is, well, is there some natural dual to this entanglement entropy? If you put this context in a field theory that has a holographic dual, so you imagine this lives on a boundary of some bulk spacetime, is there some quantity that would correspond to the entanglement entropy of this region? And a priori, you might say, well, no way, because it's already a hard quantity to deal with in the field theory in the first place, and now on top of that, we're parsing it through this very complicated mapping, which scrambles the space and all that. But surprisingly, the answer is resounding yes. It's in fact described not just geometrically, but by the simplest possible object you might have in the geometry. So for a static configuration that doesn't change in time, you can describe the entanglement entropy corresponding to the region by a minimal surface, a surface with a minimum area in the bulk that is so-called homologous to this boundary region, that's anchored on this entangling surface in such a way that the region in between has only boundaries given by this minimal surface in this bulk region A. Okay, so that's the entanglement entropy. And in fact, there has been mounting body of evidence that has been subsequently proved by Aitor here and Juan Modestina, has been now utilized very heavily. So you notice the similarity with the black hole entropy. That might not be accidental, but in a sense, you can think of this as a generalization of that relation. You also notice that this minimal surface hangs into the bulk. It's like a soap bubble, but it hangs into the bulk. That's because this is just a conformal diagram. The boundary really is infinitely far away. And so the surface, to minimize its area, it wants to get away from the boundary as quickly as possible. And in fact, because the boundary is infinitely far away, the area, the proper area, diverges. But so does the entanglement entropy in a local quantum field theory, because you have this UV divergence of modes just across the entangling surface, and the divergence is in fact match up. And so there's a meaningful physics in this relation. And in fact, it's very useful for proving various properties of entanglement entropy that are not manifest, that are less manifest holographically. Okay, let me skip this because I'm running short on time, but let me just say that there's a relation that's true for any quantum system, but holographically you can prove this relation. It's called strong subadditivity. You can prove it very easily. And the proof is as follows. So if you have entanglement entropy of some region A1 plus that of some region A2, that's always at least as large as entanglement entropy of the union of those two regions plus that of the intersection. So you relate these to the areas, you partition the areas in a different way, and now this intersection and the union are given by areas of minimal surfaces. So in particular, this surface must be bigger than the minimal area surface, and similarly for this one, and there you go. So you can prove, same proof, curiously enough, holds even for relations that don't hold universally, but do hold for any state that has a geometrical dual. Now, as before, the time direction is very important, and so far we have only talked about static cases. If you have a full Lorentzian spacetime, the prescription is meaningless, and you have to covariantize it. And in fact, the covariant description is very simple. You just replace a minimal surface by an extremal surface, again homologous to this region, and that too has been now proved, and now that's equally robust as you have from the boundary standpoint, from defining the entanglement entropy. Okay, now I was going to tell you an interesting lesson that we sort of got from this. There are many ways to covariantize. Covariantization is a really important guiding principle, but of course there's infinitely many ways to do this, and it turns out that, well, there's the actual answer, in fact, is given by some subset of these. Okay, in this case, you can describe an extremal surface as one with vanishing expansion. So you can equivalently think of it in terms of light sheets as a surface that allows a light sheet that comes all the way up to the boundary, that's sort of closest to the boundary. But in any case, there are other constructs which also sound very natural, but which turn out not to be giving the entanglement entropy. Nevertheless, they turn out to be giving other interesting things. And so the other sort of ideas were recycled later on that characterized useful things that came out later. This guiding principle of using such covariant constructs has been incredibly fruitful, even though it doesn't always lead you in the direction that you're trying to go. It does lead you somewhere eventually. Okay, so let me, again, skip ahead. All right, there was a massively underestimated how long I'm going to take, so as usual. let me jump to highlight one sort of curious features of entanglement entropy from the description that I gave you so far. So these extremal surfaces can jump under small variation, smooth variations of the boundary region. So that's curious because although the entanglement entropy itself doesn't jump, the areas don't jump discontinuously, the location jumps. And so you might wonder, why does entanglement entropy have anything to do with the location of this surface in the bulk? So on the one hand, this prescription is too local. From this UVIR correspondence that I had mentioned, you might expect that sharply defined objects in the boundary should be diffused in the bulk and vice versa. And here it sounds like the extremal surface is at a sharp location and the entangling surface is at a sharp location. It sounds a little bit too good, too refined. On the other hand, it's great because we can recover the entire bulk metric by knowing entanglement entropy of family of regions. On the other hand, the prescription I give you is too non-local, in a sense that it needs to know a global and minimal surface out of these extremal surfaces, and so it needs to know the entire bulk spacetime, and it has this sort of topological restriction. So it's a weird prescription. It mixes various ingredients which might not have naturally fitted together. For that matter, entanglement entropy itself is not just about quantum entanglement, but also has classical correlations in it, and it too is mixed. It's a sort of a weird quantity from that standpoint. This weirdness doesn't match nicely across the two sides, but it's something that's sort of mysterious. And a different recasting of this holographic entanglement entropy actually gets rid of some of these problems. The recasting is in terms of a more recent picture of something called bit threads, where you can think of an entanglement entropy associated with a region given by the largest number of sort of threads that you can send out of that region, such that the threads don't end anywhere in the bulk and are some minimal thickness. And in fact, this is equivalent to this prescription I gave you before. This is just a picture for the static case, because the threads are most restricted when passing through a bottleneck, and these bottlenecks are precisely the minimal surfaces. And in fact, this recasting then gets rid of the problem that I said a moment ago about this discontinuous change, and it ties a bit better to the quantum information theoretic quantities. You can think of the threads that maybe they're like having a connection between EPR pairs that count the entanglement. It's not quite that, but understanding what exactly it is would be very useful. And in fact, a crucial part of understanding what it is again covariantizing this picture. And the natural ways to covariantize would be, well, you might imagine that these threads have a temporal extend to something I would call flow sheets, or that they might be still one-dimensional, but now being able to traverse in the time direction. And in fact, it turns out that it seems that it's this version, they're still one-dimensional, they're not temporally extended, which is itself puzzling. Why is it that something that should carry a physical quantity, entanglement, does not have a natural description in this having a temporal extent? And so one might ask, well, what does this tell us? And so just to end on a, once we understand why are these structures natural, that would give us hint to sort of earliest observations or speculations that entanglement really is the thing that builds space-time, is the thing that that actual space-time is somehow emerging from, which there were sort of early arguments. Lenny is one of the founding fathers of this idea, and it's still something that I find personally very mysterious and should be sort of explained. So to summarize, I started talking about black holes, and I think they're very useful theoretical laboratories, partly exactly because they're such extreme objects. They underlie sort of this surprising, you might almost have said unreasonable, interconnectivity between completely different branches of physics. Holography itself, which was in part inspired by thinking about black holes, is convenient way to geometrize various concepts. And so that's great at a practical level, but it's also very mysterious. And in particular, one might ask, why is entanglement entropy turning out to be so simple geometrically, as opposed to many other measures of entanglement, some of which are also simple, but not quite as simple. Well, general covariance was a powerful guiding principle. And again, we had a whole bunch of puzzles from that. And the outstanding puzzle is, what is really the deep relation between gravity, or space-time as such, and entanglement? So, GR was formulated over 100 years ago, but black holes were not understood for 50 years in that time. And in fact, entanglement began to be understood half a century ago as well. Gauge gravity duality was formulated about 20 years ago. This holographic entanglement entropy 10, 15 years ago. And now there are all these sort of new developments which feel very exciting. And it might be that, well, we still don't know what space-time fundamentally is, okay? But it sounds like there has been so much progress in the very recent past that maybe the answer could be just around the corner. But in any case, it's an interesting landscape to explore. Thank you.
Lenny?
I noticed the timing of your discoveries is getting closer and closer.
Yes.
What is the date at which the accumulation
tomorrow.
I'm 79 years old. So
it's earlier.
Quantum information has been very useful to teach about this geometric aspect. Is there something that this geometric aspect thought the quantum information theorists didn't know? Some bound, some.
So for example, I had mentioned this this relations between. The entanglement entropies of these various, if you partition the system into multiple parts and you ask about what's entanglement entropy of a bipartition, what are the relations between entanglement entropies of various ways of bipartitioning? So this proof was very simple geometrically, and in fact the geometric proof extends to this thing that Patrick Patrick had formulated. So there's the method the method of proving this. Is very simple. It's of course, this relation only holds for quantum systems that have a holographic dual describing classical bulk geometry. But they say, you might imagine if you partition the system into many more subpartitions, they say, in fact, a whole tower of such relations. And holographically, again, there's a whole tower that holographically can be proved more easily. And it might, however, be that even if this inequality doesn't apply beyond holography, that the quantity that this gives, so this is, if you put this on one side, it's something called the tripartite information. There are other such quantities that the inequalities that you might get for further partitioning would lead to more refined or more complicated information quantities that could have important meaning even outside the realm of holography. And so the holographic considerations could be very fruitful, for example, so I'm just picking from something that I have been thinking about recently, but could be very fruitful for uncovering new such quantum information quantities. Okay, so that's one sort of getting new quantities that people in quantum information theory have not particularly been thinking about. You could inspire that using holography. You can inspire sort of new relations. The proofs that you get for various, like the strong subadditivity, universal inequalities, those are limited in the sense that the proof itself that I have presented holds only for the subset of state that has that, where this is relevant, that have a holographic dual. But nevertheless, the ultimate relation can be motivated or can be inspired by holography. Okay, so there's lots of the holography sort of transcends, the statements from holography transcend holography quite often. Okay, so that's one.
Yes. So you had a slide with the bit thread pictures. Mm-hmm. They look very much like incompressible fluids in their fluid flow diagrams. I was wondering if that analogy actually holds, or do you always have this fluid picture, or can you have dissipative processes, or
it's not so kind of, the threads are
they're like velocity lines. You know? So I'm just wondering if that analogy is it just an analogy, or can that actually be?
In fact, it's not even an analogy in the sense that they're thinking of it. It's not the threads themselves. Well, there isn't yet any physics associated with different positions along this. And the only conservation you have is this divergence-free property. So the threads themselves can be arbitrarily floppy. Near the boundary or elsewhere, their only restriction is that they have to be maximally mixed at the bottleneck. Okay, so it's not like you have a
gauge fluid correspondence.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, but they are useful recasting. They're sort of complementary recasting to this extremal surface area, and they do different. They have different job in, or they have different. You can use them for different things. So for example, what I had mentioned earlier with this monogamy of mutual information that Patrick had proved using the same method as I have shown. This thing, the fact that this relation does not hold universally, but this one does, despite the fact that the proof of it looks the same, which you can convince yourself looks the same as this, is mysterious, because you might have said, well, how come the proof doesn't know whether something is universally valid or just valid in holography? These bit threads turn out to be a nice way of realizing that this inequality is really much more deeply rooted in bulk locality than this one. Okay, so the two descriptions are useful for different things. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean,
maybe Lenny, one last question.
Yeah, I just want to say, in reference to your question, there's a whole other side that you didn't have time to talk about.
There's the complexity side, for example.
Well, the general, slightly more general, the questions of quantum chaos. Mm-hmm. And the whole subject of quantum chaos mm-hmm. has been really revolutionized by thinking of these issues.
Indeed.
That's also a second part of it, which is sort of complementary to these entanglement things.
Indeed.
Which also has Stanford roots.
And how everything you said. Because everything you said and much more. So I mean, but it does have to black holes.
Yeah.
Black holes being fast as scramblers.
motivated.
But the output is a whole almost new theory of quantum chaos and complexity that is kind of complementary to these.
Indeed.
I
completely.
Okay, given the time, let's thank Veronica again.